This tutorial is going to show you how to use the Mogees plugin with Ableton Live. For this video, I'm using a Mac. However, many of the same principles apply with the Windows version of Ableton too. So I already have the Mogees plugin installed to my computer, so I want to make sure that Able can find it. So the first thing I want to do is go up to Ableton's preferences, select file folder, and I want to use VST plugin system folders that should be on. And you can see that it will start scanning folders for plugins. If you want to use the audio unit version, you'll have to turn this on also. So now if I go to the plugins folder, I can see that Mogees is there. The Mogees plugin is an audio effect, so I want to drag it onto an empty audio track. So if this is the first time that you've used the Mogees software, you will have to register. But if you've registered before, even if that's on an iOS device, all you'll have to do is log in. So I'm going to enter my email. I'm going to make up a password. And I'm going to enter my registration code. And click register. Okay, now I'm going to get my Mogees. And I'm going to take off the cap. And I'll stick it to this frying pan. It needs to be attached very firmly, so much so that there should be quite a bit of resistance if you try and take it back off. And remember, if the sticky pad gets dirty and loses its adhesiveness, you can always just peel it off, wash it under some water, wipe away the dirt, and then wait for it to dry before putting it back on. I'm then going to plug it into the 3.5mm to 1/4-inch adapter, and then use this standard guitar cable from the adapter into channel 1 of my audio interface. I then want to set the correct level, so I'm going to select a microphone input and I'm going to start tapping with this pen as loudly as I believe I will be playing and increase the gain on my preamp gradually. It's very important that it doesn't go into the red and start clipping. If it is clipping, then the Mogees plugin will be far worse at the gesture recognition. If you find that your preamp isn't giving you enough gain, you might just want to add a utility device before the Mogees plugin and just increase the gain digitally there. So now back in Ableton, you'll want to go to your audio preferences, click on audio, and you want to make sure that your input device is the name of your sound card. It won't be exactly the same as what you see here, it'll just be the name of your device. On the audio track with the Mogees plugin, I want to set audio from to external in and channel 1, and make sure that monitor is set to in so you can hear the input. And you can see that if I start tapping, we can see some level coming in there. And it's a good level, it's not going into the red, so it's not clipping. And I can also hear the resulting sound coming out of the Mogees plugin. So here's the Mogees plugin. At the moment there are 4 sound engines, you can just click on the icons to switch between them. And each sound engine has a list of presets. Just click on the drop-down menu and select them to change. And you can fine-tune these presets by changing these slider parameters here as well if you wish. You can change the pitch by clicking on a note on the keyboard, or you can even change the octave by using this -1 or +1 buttons here. So let's say I've got a song and I want to play the melody live with my Mogees. We can send MIDI notes from a MIDI track to the Mogees plugin so that the pitch of the Mogees is always in sync with my track. So I'm going to create a new MIDI track, and I'm just going to drag this MIDI clip onto that track. And each time that I load an instance of the Mogees plugin, it creates 2 virtual MIDI buses, one to receive MIDI and one to send MIDI from the Mogees plugin. So if we go back into Ableton Live's preferences, select MIDI sync, we can see that there are now 2 new MIDI ports. Mogees number 1, input and output. We want to turn on track and remote for both the input and output of Mogees number 1. If I go back to my MIDI track, we can turn MIDI from to no input. But if you wanted to, you could receive live input from maybe the keyboard of another person in the band or something like that. We then need to set MIDI 2 to be Mogees 1. And if I hit play and go back to our plugin, we can now see that the notes on the keyboard are jumping around. If I play the Mogees, the notes that I will hear will correspond to the MIDI notes in that track. There are a couple of advanced settings that I want to draw attention to now. So if you go to the settings menu with the three lines up in the top right, you can see these parameters here. If you are using the Muon sound engine, you may want to tweak the audio gate. This simply lets all of the audio from the Muon synthesizer come through the plugin if you reduce it to zero. But if you increase it a little bit, you'll have to play a bit louder for the audio to come through. If you want the pitch to change with very gentle touches, you can reduce the trigger threshold. However, if you only want the pitch to update with very, very strong hits, you can increase the trigger threshold. So with Mogees, you can assign different types of hits or strikes to play different notes or sounds. First, you need to train the plugin to recognize these different types of taps. We call these scrapes or strikes or scratches or whatever. We call them gestures. So all we've got here is an audio track with the Mogees plugin. And I'm going to want to train my first gesture so that when I tap the handle of this pan with my thumb, I want that to trigger a bass note. So the first thing that I'm going to do is click on the plus icon. And I'm going to perform my first gesture at least a dozen times. Now, it's very important that I only see one dot appear each time I hit the pan. If more than one dot appears with each tap, then I'd want to go back to my advanced settings and increase the trigger threshold and begin the training process from scratch. However, if no dots are appearing, then I might want to reduce the trigger threshold so that it picks up quieter onsets. The trigger time slider also sets the number of onsets or hits that will be detected within a certain number of milliseconds. So if I'm playing on a really rattly or wobbly surface, like a cymbal or something that shakes a lot, I may want to increase the trigger time so that it only recognizes my hit and not the object shaking afterward. Okay, so back to my first gesture. I'm going to tap a dozen times, giving it a variety of amplitudes and playing around the area, not always exactly on the same spot. Once I'm happy, I'm going to select Done. So this circle now represents my first gesture. If I click on it, I can then choose the sound preset that I want. So I'm going to choose Mute Bass from the Blue Steel sound engine, and I'm going to select a middle C on the keyboard. So it now knows that each time I tap my thumb on the handle to play middle C on the Mute Bass preset. So I'm going to train a second gesture now. This time I'm going to use my thumb on the edge here. I want to hit plus again. Again, it's important that I provide a variety of the gesture by playing around the area I want to associate the sound to and giving it some dynamics, just as if I were performing. Click Done, and I'm going to associate it to the Mute Bass preset and select a new note. So now the plugin can tell these two gestures apart. In order to be recognized as distinct, gestures need to be quite different from one another. So for example, if I were to train a third gesture of my thumb tapping on the edge again, you'll see that these two circles are overlapping. This means that the plugin will have a hard time telling them apart. So what I'm going to do is control click or right click on this third gesture to delete it, and I'm going to use this pen instead of the thumb. Once I'm done, I'm going to select the Muon and I'm going to change the note. So now I've got three gestures. So just like we were sending MIDI information in before, I can now send different MIDI tracks to different gestures. For this example, I'm just going to use two gestures, so I'm going to right click on this one to delete it. And I'm going to create two new MIDI tracks. And then going to quickly grab these two MIDI claps and put them in those tracks. And since I've already got the MIDI information here, I can set MIDI from to be no input. And I want to send the MIDI information from both of those tracks to the Mogees number one plugin. However, I want to set the channel for track number one to be channel one, and the channel for track number two to be channel two. What this means is each of these gestures has an independent MIDI input channel. So for my first red gesture, I'm going to set that to be channel 1. And for my second blue gesture, my MIDI input channel is going to be number 2. So this means that MIDI notes from this track will go to the red gesture, and MIDI notes from this track will go to the blue gesture. I'm just going to quickly change the sound preset so that you can hear this a bit clearer for gesture number 2. So now if I hit play, the notes from this track are going to gesture 1. And the notes from this track are going to gesture 2. Mogees can also be used as a controller or a MIDI trigger by sending MIDI out. For this example, I'm going to grab a drum rack, and I'm going to set the MIDI from to be Mogees number 1. I want to set input monitoring so I can hear the triggers happening. And if I trigger my first gesture, it's triggering this sample here. I'll just need to turn down the audio of my Mogees track so you can hear it. You may need to move some samples around so that you can hear them. So this means that you can use Mogees to trigger your own samples via MIDI or control external synthesizers. You can even use something like Ableton's MIDI mapper to trigger clips, or even MIDI map effects within Ableton. So, for example, you could trigger on and off a looper by tapping on a mic stand, or control effects from the side of a drummer, different things like that. The MIDI velocity slider in advanced settings can be used to set the range of the MIDI velocities that are being output. We can even do some advanced stuff like send MIDI notes to the plugin. Use gestures to route different MIDI tracks to different gestures, but instead of using the sounds internal to the Mogees plugin, use other external MIDI instruments or synths. So I'm going to create an empty MIDI track and load a MIDI clip into that. I'm going to send that to channel 1 of the Mogees plugin. But then I'm just going to get a software synth here. And if I hit play and perform my first gesture, the notes will be coming from this MIDI track into the Mogees plugin, and then the Mogees plugin will be outputting MIDI to this instance of operator. Let's say my second gesture, I want to trigger a kick drum sample. So I'm just going to grab a sample here, throw that onto an empty audio track. This time I'm going to use Ableton's MIDI mapper. Just going to click on this clip, perform my second gesture, go back out of the MIDI mapper. I might want to set the quantization for this clip to be none so I can trigger it whenever I want. And now I can play both independently. There can be lots of cool combinations of routing different MIDI tracks to different gestures that can lead to some pretty crazy performance setups. If you load more than one Mogees plugin, you'll create 2 new virtual MIDI ports, this time with the number 2 label. So if you go back to Ableton's MIDI preferences, you'll see that there are now 2 inputs and 2 outputs, Mogees number 1 and Mogees number 2. You'll probably need to turn on the track and remote for these again. This means that you can route different MIDI tracks to different plugins independently. This could also be useful if you've got a few different Mogees going into your sound card. Please note that if you want to bounce a track that uses MIDI input to control the pitch of a Mogees plugin, you should create an empty audio track and capture the audio of the Mogees track. You can't do an offline bounce. This is one of those limitations of virtual MIDI, which means that the pitches will not be correct unless it's rendered in real time. So that's all for this tutorial. If you've got any questions, head on over to our forum.